Okay, next question, folks. Okay, we'll go over to Kimberly now. In your first term, if elected as chair of the California Democratic Party, what three pieces of legislation would you want to see enacted in the state of California?
Yeah. I'd like to see us get money out of politics. You know, I think it's beautiful that we are having this conversation on MLK Day. Dr. King was the consummate freedom fighter who fought for equity and justice and fairness for everyone. He believed in a level playing field. If we, as the Democratic Party, believe in bringing up the best and the brightest, the best that our communities have to offer when it comes to elected leadership, then shouldn't we want to make sure that the best rises to the top? Research shows that the quickest, most effective, and efficient way to do that is by getting money out of politics. So I would like to see this supermajority that we have move forward legislation that moves towards getting money out of politics to level the playing field for women, for people of color, for millennials, for LGBT, and other underrepresented communities to be able to serve an elected office. Second, I want to make sure that our new pay equity bill really becomes a reality. The truth of the matter is that in the United States of America, white women make 77 cents on the dollar. Here in California, they actually do a little better. They make about 83 cents on the dollar as to their male counterparts. But if you're a black woman, you are making 64 cents on the dollar. If you're a Latina, you're making closer to 52 cents on the dollar. I want to make sure that the bills that we have on paper are actually happening in reality. And so I want to strengthen that particular bill to make sure that that is actually happening. And lastly, if we are going to be a state that leads on climate change, let us lean into that and really lead on that. Let us ban, once and for all, fracking. When we employ bills that allow for regulated fracking, please know that that is a sleight of the hand sort of trickery that people employ to ensure that business as usual continues. As the next chair of the California Democratic Party, you can be sure of one thing. There will be no business as usual with me.
You know, the fracking point is essential. I want to take it into a broader piece here, and that's environmental justice. We've done quite well on coastal environmentalism. We've really changed the focus towards dealing with climate change, even though we're not quite there yet. We're pretty far out there. But from where we stand today, within 5 miles of us, children are being poisoned every day by acids leaching up through the earth from the factories that used to stand here. In Bakersfield, Kern County, where fracking is done in the most disastrous way, the poisoned water that comes up filled with chemicals and oil is being used to irrigate the agriculture fields. In Fresno, 56% of all kids have asthma because of particulate matter in the air. We need to pass legislation that makes environmental justice rise to the same level as all of the other environmental matters. We need to pass single-payer health care, or as close to it as we can possibly do in the state level. And once and for all, we need to legislate that no person that works doesn't earn a decent enough wage to have a roof over their head and send their kids to school every morning with a meal in their stomach. That is the cornerstone of survival in a society. But as a Democratic Party, we have to remember one other thing. Whether it's Kimberly or whether it's me, we won't be the ones casting the vote on the floor of the Assembly and on the floor of the Senate. There are 80 Assembly members and 40 senators who will turn their key or push their button how they choose. And if we don't begin a dialogue with them, if we don't begin to make clear to them what's important, we'll never succeed. Some years ago, we tried to pass a plan just to require our legislators to read our platform. Not even to sign that they agreed to it. And we couldn't get it off the ground. What we did right here in Los Angeles County was we made that a requirement of our endorsement for local office. You must sign that you have read and understood the platform of the California Democratic Party. We can't force it. We can't enforce it. But at least it's a first step towards making sure that they have seen it. And as a party, and as a party leadership, we need to be sitting at the table with those elected officials, and particularly with the legislative leaders, and saying, these are the priorities of the activists of our party. These are the priorities of the heart and soul of our party. And these are the greatest needs of the people of the state of California. So please work with us.
Eric, I'm going to stay with you on this one because it segues right into what you were commenting on. Okay, so to get those three pieces of legislation enacted, you have to build a relationship with the elected officials, be it the legislature as well as the governor. So be it that an elected official has an ongoing vote within the state house that is not progressive, not reflective of the democratic values, what do you do then as chair of the California Democratic Party?
Well, that raises an interesting question, because people often ask me, well, will you, quote, run candidates in a primary against incumbents? And what people have to remember is that you all who are the delegates decide who the party supports. That's not the chair's decision. That's not the officer's decision. We don't get to pick the candidates. The delegates do the endorsements. This is a bottom-up organization, not a top-down organization. And that's why we changed the rules on endorsements. Well, it's true. This is not the DNC. This is California. Okay, when you look at how those endorsement votes get done, it is the delegates from the districts. And by the way, I authored the plank that stopped allowing elected officials to appoint outside their district in order to be able to flood delegates into affecting endorsements. I wrote that plank. I also wrote the plank that increased the number of ADEM delegates in each district from 12 to 14. Because I thought we needed a stronger voice to speak more loudly. I didn't just wake up at this yesterday. I've been involved in this party for a long time. I know the ins and the outs. I know the goods and the bads, and I know where the skeletons are hidden. But you asked one other question. You asked about relationships. Well, Willie Brown was once asked if there were any skeletons in his closet. He said no, he had a graveyard full of them. Now I forgot what I was going to say. Oh, I don't have to begin to build relationships with our elected officials. I have those relationships. The leadership of both houses of the legislature, the majority of members of both houses of the legislature know me, work with me, and support me. And you know what? I'm pretty open and direct with them, and I always have been, and I will continue to be. But I have relationships with all of those folks now. That's why the Speaker has endorsed me, that's why the Pro Tem has endorsed me, and that's why so many of those folks have. But here's the thing. You've got to take that relationship and use it to work with them, to get them to do the right thing. You know, I think, by and large, most people who run for office in a Democratic Party really are good people who want to do good things. They might have different attitudes about things, but you know, we've had the emergence of the Mod Squad. And how did the Mod Squad come about? The Mods God came about because the business community figured out that they could no longer elect Republicans. And so they started finding Democrats that they could elect that would vote and support big oil, or that would vote against health care bills, or that would vote against minimum wage. And that's how it happened. And we have to figure our way around that. Because you know what? There are members of our party up there who are as conservative as some Republicans. And we have to figure this out. Because remember, now they have the option to be elected for 12 years if they keep getting reelected. And so we've got to work with them, or we're never going to change them.
So I think that we can try to work with them, but if that doesn't work, we work around them. I actually think that a lot of people who run for office today run for the wrong reasons. They run because they want to be something, not because they want to do something. And as a party, we do actually choose the candidates. We do that at the local level. It's another reason why we need to make sure that we are democratizing the Democratic Party in a way that opens up the local levels to more voices, more perspectives, more diverse candidates. So when our Democratic elected officials aren't doing what they should be doing, which is advocate on behalf of the people, it is our job to call them out, to hold them accountable, and to make sure that we organize to make them pay at the ballot box. What good is having relationships with people in high places if you don't actually use them to move forward progressive legislation? One of the big takeaways that came out of November 8th for me is that as a party, it is time for us to facilitate difficult conversations and to tell hard truths. And the hard truth of it is that the Democratic Party is not as democratic as we would like it to be. As a girl who was born and raised in the South, my grandmother taught me very good manners, and so I do believe in saying please and thank you. However, I do not believe that it is our job to beg and plead for what is right and what is humane, what is fair and what is just. And so we will say to our elected officials, to the governor, to the leaders of both houses of representatives, do what is right, please and thank you. And if not, we will organize and make you pay at the ballot box. It is time for us to demand.
Okay, one last question, and then we're going to go into the closing statements for each candidate. I'll just continue with Kimberly right now. Kimberly, what is your number one inspiration for running for the chair of the California Democratic Party, and what is it that you view in yourself to have the ability to hold that seat?
Yeah. I believe deeply that the California Democratic Party is at a crossroads. We are at an inflection moment in this time and in this space. I believe that the next generation of political leadership that hails from the great state of California should look like California. It should have the beautiful diversity that California has to offer. If we are going to carry the mantle of leading this country in a bigger, better, bolder way, then it is incumbent upon us to have difficult conversations, to tell hard truths, and to do the hard work of rebuilding this party. You know, I decided 2 summers ago that I was going to run for this after I had a conversation with 2 black women who summoned me down to Los Angeles. I thought, oh, they're going to be so supportive, you know, another sister running for office. Didn't quite go that way. The conversation with those two black women went something like this. Who the hell do you think you are running for this position? If you decide to run for this, it will be political suicide. No one will ever touch you again. We know you know how to fundraise. So we would advise you take that little chit and you go and ask Eric if he will give you one of the vice chair seats. But as far as running to be the next chair of the California Democratic Party, politically speaking, you will be murdered. And we will personally take part in murdering you. In that moment, and in that instance, I thought, and this is the California Democratic Party? This is not the party that I thought it was. This is not the party that espouses progressive values. In that moment, I decided, I am running to redefine this party. That does not belong in this party. If somebody, anybody feels that they want to lead, they should have the ability to throw their hat in the ring, to make their case to the voters, and to let them decide. But as a party, we should not be trying to choose who the choices are. That is not the party that I want to be a part of. It is time to give this party back to the people, and I'm running to be the next chair of this party to do just that.
When I heard that story for the first time, I was quite stunned, to tell you the truth. We can cut the sarcasm. I really was quite stunned because I don't think that way. Today we celebrated Dr. King's birthday, and amongst his biggest achievements was the fight for voting rights to make sure that everybody had the right to vote. Something that, by the way, is being unwound before us as we speak. Here's what I think. I think the California Democratic Party is among the best in our nation today. I think the California Democratic Party has had innumerable successes and done many things right and focused on many of the right issues and maintained itself as a body where two-thirds of the delegates to our state convention are grassroots delegates, not elected officials and their appointees. But that doesn't mean we can't do better, and that doesn't mean we can't do more. Oh, it is right. One-third of the delegates come from the ADEMs, one-third of the delegates come from the Democratic Central Committees, and one-third come from the elected officials and their appointees. That's where the delegates come from. My point is, we have something that has done some very good things here and has a long way to go. You know, when I put out my call to action the day after the election, and I called on the governor and the legislators to build a metaphorical legal wall around California to protect every Californian, I did it because we're the place that can do it. I said to them, we need to scrub our Constitution and our statutes and our laws and do everything we can to protect every Californian to make sure that reproductive health care choice cannot be taken away in California no matter what the Supreme Court does. To make sure that marriage equality will stay the law of California, no matter what the Supreme Court does. And by the way, if the Supreme Court were to change it today, Prop 8 is the law of California. I said that we must do everything we can to protect every child in California, that no immigrant child should be taken away and deported, that every child in California deserves a free, high-quality public education, without question, that every worker deserves a livable wage and the right to collectively bargain, that we fight climate change before our earth burns up, and that we make sure that the next generations can breathe the air and drink the water. That's the California Democratic Party I believe in. That's the Democratic Party that I have worked up and down the state to fight for 25 years. And I will tell you something. It's not always been an easy battle. Not all of our own are as progressive as most of the people in this room. Some of them are rather regressive. Some of them would say stupid things to Kimberly Ellis, like, you don't have a right to run. That's not our Democratic Party. Our Democratic Party is one that has a place for each and every one of us. And let me say this, win or lose this race, I will not stop giving my life to this party because this party has given so much to me. So I thank you all for your participation, for being here tonight, for being part of this. Because going forward together, we can win. And if we're divided and in a circular firing squad, guess what? We'll be losing.
Kimberly, you go ahead with your closing statement.
Sure thing. Again, it is just so nice to be here on MLK Day and to share this day with all of you. Dr. King was a freedom fighter. I believe that now more than ever, what the California Democratic Party needs is a freedom fighter of its own. Someone who is going to fight for fairness and justice and equity for everyone. Someone who is ready to get this party back to basics. We need a new fresh perspective, vision, and voice, and a new style of leadership in this party. A type of leadership that is not going to just expect that our Democratic elected officials do the work of the people, but a party chair who will demand it. You know, being born a woman and black in this country, I was born a fighter. I have been fighting every single day of my life. And one thing that you can be sure of is that as your next chair of the California Democratic Party, I will be a fighter for you. Thank you.
You know, we have a great future ahead of us leading our nation because all across America, they have nowhere to look but west. Because what was unimaginable, that a misogynistic, xenophobic, racist, megalomaniac could win the presidency of the United States. But he did. And his plan for America is one that should scare the hell out of all of us. Look at the cabinet this man has built. Look at the Attorney General, who on a bipartisan basis was turned down for a federal judgeship but 10 years ago. California is the one place that everybody turns to look for. And the California Democratic Party leads that way. We've been leading that way, and we must continue to lead that way. We must be together, grassroots activists and elected officials, union leaders and union members, allied groups like the League of Conservation Voters and the Sierra Club. Because you see, together in collective strength, we all have the possibility to win. But when we divide up into little boxes and little corners and little groups, guess what? We're weakened greatly. I am committed to the California Democratic Party. I am committed to leading it in a way that will be strong and forceful and outspoken. And just like when I do CNN and when I do Fox and when I do all the television shows representing our party, which I do very regularly, I take apart those Republicans on TV. I won't be afraid to take them apart here. I won't be afraid to take apart our own losers. But we have to be in this united together in the fight. And we have to prioritize the quality of life for people first, making sure that people can survive. We're sitting in a county with 46,000 homeless people on the street. We're sitting in a county that has the richest zip codes in America. Beverly Hills, Bel Air, Rancho Palos Verdes. And yet we have 46,000 people on the streets. We need to come together with strengths to help those people. And we need to come together to protect those tens of thousands of immigrants who signed up on forms for services thinking that they had a president that would protect them, when now we have a president who's going to want to come and take those lists. And the California Democratic Party and our elected officials have to be the ones leading that fight. And I got to tell you, as the chair of the Democratic Party, I'm a boy from the South Bronx. I certainly know how to punch, and I certainly know how to counterpunch. And I'll be there every step of the way. Thank you all for being here tonight.
Okay, one more time, folks. Round of applause for the candidates. Vote.